Before we prove that truncated singular value decomposition, our example, is in fact a regularization, I would like to get another example of regularization. And that's Tikhonov regularization is probably the most famous and mostly used type of regularization in inverse problems, Harvard. Okay, interestingly enough, it's not that old. So although that method has been around for a very, very long time, the mathematical analysis has been done by Tikhonov and Phillips in about 1963, so it's about 50 years old. For me, that's not that old, so it's relatively modern mathematics. Okay, definition 3.3, I hope that number is correct. We call F alpha a Tikhonov regularizer of Kf equals g, if and only if F alpha is the minimum, the argument minimum of norm Kf minus g squared plus alpha squared norm F squared. Now that needs some explanation. If I set alpha equal to zero, then all we have here is the least squares definition, right? And the idea behind this could be that if we take the least square solutions, they might get very big, and we want to prevent that. So instead of minimizing the norm of Kf minus g, we minimize the norm of Kf minus g plus alpha squared times the norm of f. So that makes sure that our solutions f do not get too large. Of course, in the framework of the regularizers, we would assume that we have some alpha that is chosen based on some error level delta and some g delta. And also we assume throughout this analysis that alpha is larger than zero. Now, of course, we have to prove that this argument minimum actually exists. And I just noted if we set alpha equal to zero, then we just have least squares, and then no minimizer exists because then it's just the least square solution. Okay, for the analysis, we first define an operator K alpha bar that goes from X to the product space of Y and X. And we define K alpha bar, and I think I should move here so you can see my mouse. We define K alpha bar of F as the product in the product space as Kf and alpha F. And writing it in matrix form, this would be nothing just but K alpha I times F, where I is the identity operator. If I define G bar as G zero in the product space, then we find that the norm of K alpha bar F minus G bar in the product space, and we only look at Hilbert spaces here, would be defined as would be norm Kf minus G squared plus alpha squared times the norm of F squared. Okay, so if alpha is that minimizer, is a minimizer of this right-hand side, then that means that F alpha is in fact a least square solution of K alpha F alpha equals to G bar. K alpha bar F alpha equals to G bar. So if F alpha minimizes this functional over here, then it is a least square solution of this equation. Okay, if it's a least square solution, then that means it must satisfy the normal equation. So K alpha bar adjoint times K alpha bar times F alpha should be equal to K alpha bar adjoint times G. And inserting our definition up here, this is nothing but K adjoint K plus alpha squared I times F alpha is equal to K adjoint applied to G. Now, this looks very much like the normal equation if you set alpha to zero, and in fact, this is the normal equation, and the usual name for this is the regular Tikhonov regularized normal equation. Okay, we want to show that there always is a least square solution. So we'll have to show that this operator is in fact invertible. So we set A equals to K adjoint K plus alpha squared I. And definitely A is not compact, by the way. Think why that is the case. And I'll note some properties of this operator now. Well, obviously, A is a self-adjoint operator from X to X. And we'll now assume that K is at least continuous, and then that means that A is continuous as well. Then A is injective, and the reason is if you take the scalar product of A, U, and U, and that's the usual way that we've done this quite a lot of times now, then this is K star K plus alpha squared I times U, scalar product with U, U. Throw the K adjoint to the right-hand side, then this is the norm of KU squared plus alpha squared times the norm of U squared. And of course, this is larger or equal to alpha squared times the norm of U squared. And this is larger than zero for U not equal to zero. So we can note that for if AU can only be zero if U is zero, which means that U is injective. Also, since we have for u not equal to zero, AU u is larger than zero, A is in fact positive definite. Okay, now we want to show that A is invertible. For that, we write the source space X as the range of A plus the kernel of A adjoint, but A is self-adjoint, so that's the kernel of A. And we showed that the kernel of A is just the zero. So if we can show that the range of A is closed, then we have that all of X is the range of A. And that means that the operator is injective and surjective, which means that it's bijective. Now, first of all, we note that for any u in X, we have that the norm of u squared is smaller or equal to 1 of alpha squared times AU scalar product with u. That's exactly what we already had above here. Now, using Cauchy-Schwarz, this is smaller or equal to 1 over alpha squared times norm AU times the norm of U. And dividing by the norm of U, this gives us the norm of U is smaller or equal to 1 over alpha squared times the norm of AU. Okay, now assume that you have a sequence in the range of A that converges to some V. And then definitely UN is a Cauchy sequence. AUN is a Cauchy sequence. But due to this inequality, we have that the norm of UN minus UM is smaller or equal to 1 over alpha squared times AUN minus UM. And since this is a Cauchy sequence, this goes to 0 for N and M going to infinity. So that means that UN is a Cauchy sequence as well, which means that it's convergent because we're in Banach spaces or Hilbert spaces. We're in Hilbert spaces. Now, since A is continuous, we have that AUN converges to AU, but we assumed that AUN converges to V. So that means AU is equal to V, or V is already in the range of A, which means that the range of A is closed, and that means that A is bijective or invertible. Last, let me note that A to the minus 1 is also continuous. We have, we already had that above here, A to the minus, set U equal to A to the minus 1 V for any V in X, and this now makes sense because A to the minus 1 exists. A to the minus 1 V is more or equal to 1 over alpha squared times A to the minus 1 V, which is just the norm of V. So we have that the norm of a to the minus 1 is smaller or equal to 1 over alpha squared, which means that a to the minus 1 is also continuous. Okay, so we proved that this normal equation is uniquely solvable, which means that there is exactly one least square solution for this problem. And this in turn means that there is exactly one minimizer of this functional on the right-hand side, and denoting that by F alpha absolutely makes sense. Okay, so let us note this. Write it in lemma 3.4. Let K, a continuous linear operator from X to Y, X and Y, no, not Banach spaces, Hilbert spaces, I'm sorry. Because I definitely used Hilbert here. Then Tikhonov regularization is well defined and it's continuous. So it depends continuous on the right hand side for any alpha larger, for any fixed alpha larger than zero. And the Tikhonov regularization is given by K adjoint K plus alpha squared I to the minus 1 applied to K adjoint G. The proof is now extremely easy because that's F alpha plus, I should say. So pre-writing is nice, oops. So pre-writing is nice, but then it should be. I think you get the idea, right? Let me write it this way. F alpha plus is k star k plus alpha squared I to the minus 1 k star g. And the proof is easy. This the k star k plus alpha squared I, that was our A, which was defined to be invertible. So we have this equation. And this is the norm, this is the least squares equation, which F alpha plus has to satisfy. So this is correct. And we have that the norm of A to the minus 1 K adjoint is more or equal to the norm of A minus 1, which we showed to be finite, times the norm of K adjoint. And this is smaller than infinity. So this is also a continuous operator. So Tikhonov regularization defines a continuous operator. Okay, the question you may ask with respect to the definition that I gave is this in fact a regularization? And the other thing is, what happens if K is a compact operator? Now, if K is compact, then we have a singular system. So we assume now that sigma K, UK, and VK is a singular system for K. And we want to solve the inverse problem as above, Kf equals g. And the Tikhonov regularization for that we write as sum of all k, ak, uk plus u perp. And that's possible because uk is a complete system. Uk is an orthonormal system. Well, we. UK is a singular system, so every element in X can be represented this way. Okay, now we already saw that then F alpha plus has to satisfy the normal equation above. So let me write this down again. This is K star K plus alpha squared I times F alpha plus. Now, K star K, we already wrote that down. That can be computed as sum over all K sigma K squared UK scalar product with F alpha plus times UK. So that we computed that when defining the SVD. And for this one, we have alpha squared times F alpha plus. Now we plug in our representation of F alpha plus, observe that the UK are an orthonormal system. Then the left-hand side over here becomes sum over all K, AK sigma K squared times UK. And from this part over here, we have something like sum over all K, alpha squared AK times UK. plus alpha squared times u perp. And the first part I plug in here. So this ak alpha squared uk I put in here. So with the brackets, I can write it this way. Okay, this has to be equal to k adjoint applied to g. Now, this is nothing but sum over all k, sigma k, g, and vk times uk, according to our singular value representation. And comparing coefficients here, we find that there's only one way for the AK to satisfy this equation. First of all, u perp has to be zero. And we have to choose AK as sigma k over sigma k squared plus alpha squared. Okay, and once we have the AKs, we can write the our Tikhonov regularization in terms of the singular value decomposition. And we have that f alpha plus can be written as sum over all k sigma k over alpha squared plus sigma k squared scalar product of g and vk times uk. And that's, I think I left out something here. The AK is, of course, that means I left out the G and VK over here. Yes. Yeah. Because it has to be the sigma K times G and VK, and dividing by the sigma K square plus alpha square, we arrive at this. Okay, so the question that we need to ask, answer if we want to show that this is a regularization is, does this converge to the to the minimum norm solution, which would be given by k plus g, and that would be sum over all k, 1 over sigma k, g and vk times uk. And what we can observe here is, at least for alpha going to 0, the coefficients we have here converge to each other pointwise, right? I mean, for alpha going to 0, this over here converges to 1 over sigma k, and that's kind of nice. So this is something that we would expect, and we might ask, maybe that's enough. So if the coefficients here converge locally, converge pointwise to each other, maybe that already means that the procedure that we have here is a regularization. And that's exactly what we're going to prove.